There can be little doubt of there being a northern communication of some sort by sea between this west side of America and the east side through Baffin's Bay. Captain James Cook, Aleutian Islands, October 1778. Britain was challenging Spain's claim to sovereignty over the region and their attempts to find the Northwest Passage. As early as 1592, Juan de Fuca, a Greek mariner employed by Spain, believed he had found a route here. There were also stories of a possible route found by the Spanish admiral Bartholomew de Fonte in this location in 1640. The Hudson Bay Company employed Samuel Hearn and Matonabbee, a Dene guide, to explore overland routes. They reached the Arctic Ocean at the mouth of the Coppermine River in 1771. Around the same time, maps showing Russian discoveries gave rise to the idea of a clear water passage to the north and east across the top of America. Could a passage be this far north? The British speculated it was likely and commissioned Captain James Cook to investigate. In January 1778, the expedition reached Hawaii. They were the first Europeans to visit and map the archipelago. Cook was welcomed by hundreds of islanders as an honored guest. Some believe the Hawaiians thought that Cook was an incarnation of the Polynesian god Lono. By March, the expedition was approaching the northwest coast. They were thwarted by storms. Consequently, they missed Juan de Fuca's strait and were too far offshore to look for Admiral Fonte's passage. Cook's journal shows he was skeptical about both of these routes. For my own part, I give no credit to such vague and improbable stories. The ships anchored near the village of Yuquot. Cook mistakenly named the village Nootka, having misinterpreted the Mauichat people when he arrived. They would paddle round both ships, a chief or other principal person standing up with a spear. They would come alongside and begin to trade without further ceremony. Their articles were the skins of animals, in particular the sea otter. Captain Cook, April 1778, Ship Cove. The sailors traded with the Mauichat people for supplies of wood, water, oil, fish, and furs in exchange for mainly metal objects, a rare material in Yuquot. During their stay, John Weber and other ship's artists made detailed drawings documenting life in the community. These would later appear as engravings in the expedition's published journal, which became a de facto guidebook for the region. After nearly a month at Yuquot, Cook resumed his survey and renaming of the northwest coast. They were in Prince William Sound by May, Cook Inlet in June, and Icy Cape by August. Cook was convinced the passage was at 71 degrees north, but ice prevented them sailing further. The expedition returned to Hawaii in January 1779 for repairs and supplies. Although they were welcomed back at first, a disagreement followed, and Cook was killed by the Hawaiians on February 14th. The crew continued their mission. On their way home, they learnt that the sea otter pelts they purchased in Yuquot could sell for a huge profit in China. A good pelt sold for $120. That's worth almost $3,000 today. The sea otter story attracted a lot of interest among British Navy sailors. Many of them were on half pay after the American Revolutionary War ended in 1783. In 1785, the first British fur trading ship arrived at Yuquot. The following summer, seven British fur traders were in the area. Fortunes were made. In 1787, Captain Nathaniel Portlock and George Dixon sold 2,552 furs for $54,875 in Canton. That's worth about $1.4 million today. The indigenous communities, long established trade networks, quickly included British and American goods. A number of trade centers emerged among the coastal communities. Each chief's power and influence grew with their increased wealth.
Initially, it was not a bad thing to begin with. However, as time has gone on, we realized that perhaps it didn't turn out so well for First Nations people.
In 1788, financed by a conglomerate of British and Asian trading companies, John Meares, a former Royal Navy lieutenant, arrived in Yuquot. He built a schooner there and claimed he bought land from the Mauichat chief, Maquina, to build a trading post. By the spring of 1789, several American and British fur traders were anchored in Yuquot. Spain was increasingly concerned about its sovereignty claims over the region. In addition to the growing British presence, they were monitoring Russia's fur trading activities in the Aleutian Islands. An expedition there in 1788 reported that the Russians had expanded their network significantly. 6 new trading posts and a large settlement on Kodiak Island. In May 1789, 2 Spanish frigates arrived in Yuquot, commanded by Captain Esteban Jose Martinez. They officially took possession of the cove and built a gun battery at the harbor entrance. Later, the Argonaut fur trader arrived in July with Chinese laborers and supplies for John Meares' trading post. An argument erupted between Martinez and the ship's captain, James Colnett. Accusing the British fur traders of trespassing on Spanish territory, Martinez seized the ships and arrested the crew. In the midst of the skirmish, Chief Calicum, the brother-in-law of Chief Maquina, was killed by the Spanish. John Meares returned to England from China in April 1790 with news of the injustices his trading company had suffered and asking for government help. How would the British government respond to these Spanish offenses?